Good afternoon. My name is Saka. I'm presenting SSL class for today. Glad you're all joined. I guess some people thought it will be taped and are in the other room as well. Okay. So a little bit about me. I started working for a Dutch internet provider halfway in the mid the 90s, and I've been in networking ever since. At ABN AMRO, and also in that time I was started using Ethereal and Wireshark, and I started working for a reseller company mainly solving F5 products, so I've got a lot of experience in load balancing, and then there were a lot of bugs, so I needed to do a lot of troubleshooting, and that's why I started developing for Wireshark myself, because I missed some features. About 7 years ago, I started my own troubleshooting company, Simbit. I do Wireshark training and I do troubleshooting gigs for customers. And I do that based from Haarlem, but I work in the whole of Netherlands, maybe also abroad. If I'm done doing any technical stuff, I like to dive or watch movies or go to techno parties. And so if you want to talk to me about that, that's fine too. All right, who trusts this company, Netlog? You don't trust it? And this one? This one? Never heard of? This one? Who trusts the Diginotar still? Nobody? Okay, but I'm telling you, you trust these three companies that I mentioned earlier. Those are the ones that you trust your banking account with, because those are all root CAs. So we don't know it, but our browser contains a lot of trust authorities, and you don't even know about them. They're spread all around the world, and we trust them. So have you ever think that SSL is just about encryption? Who thinks it's just about encryption? One person, all right. So what is it about in SSL? Is it just encryption? You think it's encryption, but the rest thinks it's different. So what is it about? Knowing that the other party is. Yeah, the answer is knowing that the other party is who he thinks, or who you think he is. So it's about authentication as well. It's about authorization. So who has run into trouble setting up SSL connections? Just a few, okay. And did you use Wireshark to troubleshoot that? Was it difficult? Okay, that's why you're here, okay. Did you have to analyze application traffic as well? So not only SSL setup, but also application traffic within SSL. Some people are nodding, okay. Did you do decryption? Yeah. So you ran into troubles. Well, we're gonna talk about decryption a lot in this session, so I hope I can solve your problems. So why do we need SSL in the first place? When I say SSL, I mean SSL and TLS, because SSL is now deprecated, so it's only TLS mostly, but everybody still calls it SSL. So why do we need it? So security and authentication. Okay, so we don't want anybody to listen to our traffic. We want to make sure that we're talking to the right person. Also, we want to make sure that nobody changes our message. So the first part is confidentiality, of course. Then message integrity, because we want to know that if I'm transferring $10 or 10 euros, I don't want it to make to be 10,000, unless I'm receiving it. Some authentication, of course, because if I'm talking to my bank, I want to make sure that I'm talking to my bank and not somebody in between. And the way we do that is by using some cryptography. So for confidentiality, we need to do encryption and decryption. For message integrity, we need some message digest or signing, so we can have a check whether the message is still in its original form. And for authentication, we have certificates and certificate authorities, of course, because otherwise you wouldn't have certificates. And that's what I'm going to talk about in this session. A little bit on cryptography, so everybody's on the same page. And then I started looking at how the SSL session has been set, will be set up, what you can troubleshoot in there, and also how you can decrypt in which cases you can or can't decrypt. And so let's see where we're going. Okay, so cryptography. The first part is symmetrical encryption. With symmetrical encryption, you have the same key for encryption and decryption, which means, which turns out to be computatively very cheap, or at least not very expensive. And you use short keys, like 40 to 256 bits. And some standards are DES and triple DES, AES in several bit lengths, and RC4, which is deprecated by now, but it used to be a symmetrical cipher. So you take a message, you encrypt it with a key. It will be an encrypted message. You send it to the other side, and the other side has the same key to decrypt the message, and you get your clear text document or clear text data back. Next to, if you would use that to communicate to a website, the website would have a key. Somehow I receive the key from the website, and we can communicate securely. And then somebody else comes along, also gets the key, and they can communicate securely. The problem is, anybody who has the key can then decrypt the data flow. So your data is not safe. So we need something else to, because you can't call a website like, give me a key, and then you get your own key, and then you can encrypt. So you need something to exchange those keys. And that's where asymmetrical encryption comes into place. With asymmetrical encryption, you have one key for encryption and another key for decryption. And they both form a pair connected to one another. This is to calculate the keys, or to use the keys, is a very expensive calculation CPU-wise, which means long keys. And we used to have RSA and DSA, and now elliptical curve cryptography is coming into place. I will talk about that later on a bit. But basically, it means you have a document or some data. You encrypt it with one of the keys. In this case, I'm encrypting it with a public key, which means I get a document that can only be decrypted with a private key. So if the server administrator keeps this key private, nobody else can view this message except for him. So I transfer it to the other side. He uses his private key to decrypt it, and there's the. Then you get your original data back. So you can use this maybe to exchange a key. So now I have a server and a user. When the server has transmitted its public key to the user, it's public, so everybody can view it. That's not a problem. So now the user can create a key, a session key, and send it, encrypt it with a public key, send it to the server. The server with a private key can now decrypt the message and retrieve the original session key. This is basically how SSL works. I will talk about that later on. But now, if somebody is in between, if he just listens to the session, he can't decrypt it. He can't get the key because he doesn't have the private key of the server. But there's another problem, like the authentication problem. If I'm talking to what I presume is my bank, and I'm exchanging keys with the public and private key pair, how do I know that the public key that I received from my bank is actually the private key from my bank? There might be somebody in between, and when they communicate with the bank on the other side of the connection, they can just proxy my connection to the bank and change data on the fly when I'm sending my transaction to the bank. So that's why we need certificates. Certificates, according to Wikipedia, is an electronic document that utilizes a digital signature to bind together a public key with an entity, with an identity. So the identity in this case is, for instance, my bank. So when I want to talk to my bank, I want to know that if I receive a public key, I want to know that the public key is belonging to my bank and not somebody else. Then, what is signing? We haven't talked about signing yet. And who is doing the signing? So let's see what assigning is. To be able to assign a message, we create a message digest. A message digest is a little, is like a CRC check. So it's irreversible. You can't make, well, that's the whole purpose. You can't make another, you can't create another document that creates the same message digest. If that's possible to do that by hand, then the message digest algorithm is not good anymore. So it's collision resistant. You can't create the document from the digest. And so these are examples. And as you see, I put some in red because MD5 and SHA-1, MD5 has been cracked. SHA-1 is, it has been proved that it can be cracked. It hasn't been done yet, but it can be proved that it could be cracked with modern technology. So these days, only SHA-2 and upcoming SHA-3 are ciphers that are or digests that are considered safe. So how does that work? We have a document, and then we use the algorithm to create a cipher. It's just like a CRC check. Then when we want to do signing, we create the message digest. And from the message digest, we encrypt it with some private key, which means everybody with a public key can verify the content of this of the document. So how does that work? I have a document. I create the message digest. Then I encrypt the message digest with my private key, with the public key. I send the document and the signature over to the other side, and then the other side can check. Of course, calculate the digest of the document that it received, and it can decrypt the message the signature. And when you decrypt the signature, the result will be another digest, message digest. Those two should be the same. If they're not, then this document has been changed on the way from the sender to the receiver. So with this algorithm, or this method, we can have something like we call a PKI, a public key infrastructure. The start of the public key infrastructure is that we have a third party that we trust. So what does this party do? It creates an identity for itself and a public-private key pair. And then it creates a certificate by signing its own key. So it uses its own private key to sign its public key, which is kind of doesn't make sense because you need to trust yourself. Well, of course you trust yourself. But now that you have created this certificate for yourself, you can use it to sign other certificates. But it's only useful if people trust your organization, trust your certificate. So you first need to send your certificate, your root certificate, your CA certificate. You need to send it to the people that need to use it. So how is that being done for us? All the browser vendors, they include the root certificates of trusted CA parties. So if you look in your browser, there's a list of 100, 200, I don't know how many these days, CA certificates that are trusted by your web browser vendor. And there's a whole consortium that are evaluating the commercial certificate authorities. And they're not put in their browser unless they fulfill certain security aspects. So now the customer has the root certificate. Now, say I'm a web shop and I want to be able to provide services to all the people in the world. So I need to be trusted. So I'm turning to a certificate authority, which means I create an identity and a key pair for myself. Then I send my identity and my public key of the key pair to the certificate authority. They create a document, a certificate, they first check, of course, whether I am who I tell them that I am. If I'm asking for a certificate for ABN AMRO.nl, all certificate authorities should say, no, you can't have that. So if I'm saying I'm Cinbit, which is my company, they will check whether I'm indeed Cinbit. And there's different ways of checking that. More than some modern CAs, they just check whether you are able to receive an email on the domain, which is not really, really secure, but it's a start. And if you use an extended validation certificate, there's a lot more being done to prove that you are really the company that you say that you are. So once they checked the identity, they will sign my identity, and my identity is the name of my website, www.simbit.nl. And they take my public key, they create a signature for that, and together with the identity and the public key, it's a certificate, and they send me back the certificate. So with that certificate, I can host my website. Whenever somebody comes to my website, I send them my certificate, and whoever gets my certificate can check whether it's been signed by this trusted certificate authority. Why? Because it's signed by their private key. So only they were able to sign it in the way that it's been signed. So when I check with their public key from their certificate, I can decrypt the signature and make sure that the certificate and the public key is indeed belonging to me. So when I verify that, I create my session keys, I send the session keys encrypted with the public key from the certificate to the server, and then I'm set, I have a session and I can communicate. And the other side is able to decrypt my session key because they have the private key belonging to the public key in the certificate. So that's in a nutshell how SSL is working. Of course, there's intermediate CAs because you don't want to... there's root CAs, and you can have a whole chain of CAs. And that works by having one of the CA have its certificate signed by the root CA, and then it can sign certificates for a server. And whenever I receive, or I want to connect to this server, I receive a certificate and also receive the intermediate certificate. So first I can check the authenticity of the intermediate certificate by using the already in my key store available root certificate. If this is valid, then I can check whether this was signed actually by this valid intermediate CA. And of course you can put multiple CAs underneath this to create a whole chain. So what happens if there's a man in the middle in this case? So I have my whole chain of certificates, I have an eavesdropper, a man in the middle, and I'm connected by DNS hacking or rerouting. I'm not connected to my bank, instead I'm connected to the server of the man in the middle. Since he is not ABN AMRO, or not bank in my case, he can't get a certificate for the bank. So he just creates a fake name and creates a certificate signed by a valid certificate tree. So it's a valid certificate, so my browser should say it's valid. But it's not, it's fake and it's not bank. And I requested my browser to go to bank.nl. So my browser will say, okay, you were trying to go to bank.nl, but the identity of the certificate that you received is not bank.nl, but fake.nl. So my browser won't allow me to make the connection. Or it will allow me to make a connection when I say, click on a disclaimer, okay, I know what I'm doing. Which I hope you are. So that's how man in the middle attacks are being prevented by using certificates. So what happens if the server private key has been compromised? So now the man in the middle is now able to pretend he's the bank because he can receive the certificate from the original web server. He has the private key, so he can pretend to be bank. Connect me, he's proxying my request so he can change my data, and I have a big problem. Then there's something in a certificate authority that's called CRL, Certificate Revocation List, or OCSP, Online Certificate Status Protocol. And then you can check the status of a certificate. So if once I know that my private key has been retrieved, then I can tell my CA, please revoke my certificate so it can't be used anymore. So that's how you protect against theft of private keys. So once that has been done, my browser will say, okay, www.bank.nl, the original certificate has been compromised, so you can't use it anymore. What happens when a CA gets compromised, like in the case of DigiNotar? The attacker can just create a new certificate with the same credentials, because the check whether I'm really the bank is not being done. And they can pretend with a different certificate than the original one, but a valid, because it's been signed by a trusted CA. They can present to you the bank, and I'm still in trouble. That's why there's a lot of security rules in place for a CA, how they must do their operations, because this is a real problem. And this is what happened when DigiNotar, it was able to create certificates through a hack. And so they didn't get the key of the certificate authority, but they were able to create new certificates without checking identity. So there was a Google certificate being created and stuff like that. Okay, so this all comes down to trust. It's a trust model. And we trust our browsers that they choose the right certificate authorities to trust. So back to the SSL protocol. Let's see how a handshake for SSL is working. First, a little bit of history. It's been started in 1994, SSL version 1 by Netscape. Nobody knows Netscape anymore, but it's the predecessor of Mozilla. Then there was version 2, which is one that was used in the beginning, but it was quite quickly it became insecure. So then SSL v3 came along, and that also has been deprecated by now. So you should only be using TLS, starting with version 1.0. It's actually the same protocol, but this is since it's now in the RFCs, it had to use a different name, so it's now TLS. Then version 1.1 came out in 2006, 1.2 in 2008, and that's what you see mostly nowadays in browsers. And version 1.3 is in the making. The 16th draft has been, written in October or September. And so that's what we will be seeing later on. Okay, so where does SSL fit in the whole TCP/IP stack? It's between transport and application layer, which it also means it's protocol independent. You can use it for any protocol that can be transported over a TCP. So you first have IP, TCP, then you get all the protocols, and in between we do SSL or TLS. SSL itself is being based on two layers. You have the record layer, and on top of the record layer there's four types of content types for SSL, and we're going to walk through each of them. So first there's the record layer. The record layer provides some fragmentation, so the maximum message in a record layer is 2 to the power of 14, which is quite large. I've never seen that. Well, I've seen one fragmented SSL record in my life. Usually you don't see it. All the packets are smaller than that. There can be multiple SSL messages of the same content type in one record. Then each record can be split over multiple TCP segments, but there can also be multiple SSL records in one TCP segment. So it's a layered structure where it can get pretty complicated in deciphering where the boundaries are. But basically, you almost never have to troubleshoot at the record layer. If there's SSL connection setup problems, it's always in the handshake layer, and those are small messages, and those are easily easy to follow. So what are the four content types? We have handshake protocol. It's responsible for setting up the SSL session. Then there is a change cipher spec, which means I'm now finished setting the encryption up, and I'm starting from my next message, it will be encrypted. Then there's an alert protocol, which tells the other side, okay, there was some error. Either was just a warning, or it can be a fatal error, and then you need to tear down the connection. And then there's, of course, application protocol, because the whole purpose of SSL is not setting up SSL connections, it's transferring data securely. So that's where we have the application protocol content type. How do we troubleshoot that? Well, first, we need to choose the right settings, because Wireshark has a lot of settings that can mangle with SSL troubleshooting. First of all, we need to reassemble fragmented IP datagrams. You don't see fragmentation that much, but make sure that this is on. The same goes for TCP. We want to allow the subsector to reassemble TCP streams. We need to have the whole SSL records, otherwise it won't work. Also, disable the validated TCP checksum. Why? Because if a checksum is wrong, then TCP will not do reassembly. And since there's a lot of systems that do TCP checksum checking on the network card and not on the system itself, the calculation will be done after WireShark sees it, and you can't do any decryption. So these are the settings that are working the best. Then in the SSL layer, you also can enable reassembly for the SSL records, but also for application data. So please enable those two as well, otherwise you won't be able to do any proper analysis. This will be listed in your preferences file as these values, and you can use them in T-Shark as well to do SSL troubleshooting in T-Shark. So the record layer. Here's an SSL packet, and there's a content type of the handshake. So I see that there's the record layer is having a header saying the content of this record layer is a handshake message. The version is TLS 1.0, and the length of the message is 65. Okay, so those are the bytes in the hex pane. Then there's a client hello, that's the content of this SSL record, and that's the 65 bytes that were mentioned here. Then after the server hello, there's a little comma here, and we have this is the server hello. There's extra data. So what is that? Well, that's the fragmentation or the segmentation of the SSL record, because there's a second SSL record in the same packet, but it's not being fully transmitted yet because it's been segmented by TCP. So there's a message that's supposed to be 2,332 bytes long, so that can't be put in this one packet, so it needs to be reassembled by TCP. And that's what you see here. I've got two packets, packet 6 and 7, and I took some part of packet 6 and some part of packet 7 and put them together in one TCP record. And this is the SSL record that you see here. So there's one SSL record, and it contains, two SSL handshake messages. One is a certificate, and the other one is a server hello. This packet plus this packet together, if you add the header size, it all adds up to 2,346. So as long as you keep reassembly enabled on all the different levels, you won't have to bother with recollecting all the data and doing that yourself. WireShark does that for you and presents the SSL records for you. If you don't do any reassembly, this is what you will see: a server hello, and then some unreassembled packet, and then an ignored unknown packet because it's in the middle of the second SSL record, so you won't see what the content is. So when we set up a SSL connection, you see here the packets in how they're shown in WireShark. This is how it's been done. First is the client hello, then the server hello, the certificate, the server hello done, client key exchange, change cyberspec, and then some encrypted handshake message, a change cyberspec from the other side, and an encrypted handshake message. So I'll go into each of these messages now for you. First, there's the client hello. It's a message type 1, has a certain length, and in it is at first the random. The random is just a blob of random bytes, and often, but not always, the first, I think, 84 bytes of it are a GMT or an epoch timestamp. So whenever you do troubleshooting, you can use it to determine what the clock was on the sending on the client or on the server. because it also has a random. So you can use it in your troubleshooting to see, is the clock on the client, is it correct, or is it maybe off by a couple of days or so. Then there's a session ID length. In this case, it's 0. If you want to resume an SSL session, you're going to use a session ID. We're going to see that later on. Then we have cipher suites. A cipher suite is the way the encryption variables will be set up, which what kind of handshake will be used, or what kind of key exchange or generation will be used, what will be the cipher used for encrypting the data in the application phase, how will it be signed, will it be signed with SHA or with MD5, or SHA-1 or SHA-2. This is an offer from the client to the server, and the server will pick the best one or the one that he finds best. There's no certain preferences, but every server has its own preferences. So the server will pick any of these to communicate with. We will see that in a minute. Then there's compression. It's not being used up to date, so you will usually see that this is there's no compression being done, so only the null method will be offered. And then there will be some extensions. I'm not going to go into extensions at the moment. The server hello is a bit of the same. We have the random again. Again, there's a timestamp in it. And then there's the session ID length. And this is the server offers to do session resumption. So it caches all the data from the session in its memory, and it will index out by the session ID. So whenever the client comes back with this session ID, you can just restart the session without having to exchange the session key. So the server chose this cipher from the list that the client offered. In this case, it's an RSA key exchange. The block encryption will be, the bulk encryption will be done with AES 256, and no compression has been chosen for this connection. Next, the server will send its certificate. Why? Because the client needs to verify the certificate. So the certificate will be sent. And in this case, you see two certificates. Why? Because it's been signed by an intermediate CA. So the server has to provide its own certificate, but also the intermediate certificate, because the client needs, with its root certificate, needs to make a connection for all three certificates. So the first one is this one is the server certificate, and the other one is the intermediate certificate. So what's in a certificate? We have a version, serial number. Serial number has been assigned by the certificate authority. The issuer, which is the certificate authority, when is it valid? So every certificate has a starting date and an ending date, so to make sure that it's been to reduce the time frame in which the key can be compromised. The subject, so that's the identity of the certificate. Then the public key, and then some extensions. So the most important part is the subject, the issuer, and the public key, and of course the validity. So what is the subject, the identity? It's there are several fields, but the most important one is the common name, which is this one. Because that's the one that will be checked by your client software to check whether the certificate matches the site that you're going to. If I'm going to www.bank.nl and I get a certificate for the pet shop, then there's something going wrong. In the certificate, there's an issuer. So the issuer in this certificate, which is Sharkfest Lab Service EA, must match the subject, of course, in the intermediate certificate. They need to match to create the whole chain. And of course, the issuer in this certificate should match the subject in the root certificate. And that way, you can create the whole chain. After the certificate has been exchanged to the client, and the client checks the certificate, and he feels he doesn't check it yet, but after the certificate has been sent, the server sends a hello done message. It's a very simple message just saying, okay, I'm done with the handshake. And then the client will check the certificate, And when the certificate is OK and he still wants to set up the SSL connection, he will create a session key, encrypt the session key with the public key from the certificate, and sends it to the other side. And that's the key exchange message. So here is a blob of data, which is the encrypted pre-master secret that will be sent to the other side. The pre-master secret is something that will be decrypted by the server. It will create all the session keys from that pre-master secret. So it's a very important message, especially when you want to do decryption in Wireshark. You need to have this message because there is a session key listed. Then next, the client will tell the server, OK, from now on, I will start to do encryption. That's the change cipher spec. And after saying that, it will send a finished message. A finished message will mean, OK, I'm done with the handshake. And to make sure no data has been mangled with, it will have a hash of all the previous sent messages. So the server can check whether he has the same hash, and then they know that nothing was changed in between. So without decryption, you will see an encrypted handshake message. But if decryption is working, you will see that it's actually the finished message. So this is the first check. If you ever do encryption and decryption in Wireshark, check whether your finished messages are sent in the clear. After decryption, they are clear, because then you know that the decryption works. Okay. Then after that, the server starts using the encrypted channel, so change cipher spec from the server. And of course, the server also sends a finished message to tell the client that it's finished with the handshakes. Again, with decryption, you will see the message as finished instead of encrypted handshake message. So what happens when you use a Diffie-Hellman cipher? When a cipher is being used that uses Diffie-Hellman as a key generation protocol instead of key exchange with RSA encryption, then there's an extra message between the certificate and the hello done from the server, and that's the server key exchange. So the server will send, if you know the Diffie-Hellman protocol, both sides create a secret. They send some, they add their own stuff to the secret, then they send it to the other side. Again, their own secret will be added, and they create something that they both know what it is, but an intermediate device can't know what it is. So that's why the server sends a server key exchange as well at the moment, and it will be combined with a client key exchange, so both can deduct the pre-master secret from these two messages. And then the rest of the session goes the same. Well, the server key exchange message is, again, a simple message transferring some keying information. When you do client authentication, so far this is just us proving that the server is actually the server that it tells you that it is. But the server might ask, OK, I want to know whether I'm talking to the right client. And that's why client authentication can be done. So you have a little pass with a certificate on it you use in your laptop, and the server can determine that you are actually have that identity. The same as before, but now between the certificate and the server hello done, there's a certificate request. So the server asks for a certificate from the client. The server hello done. Then the client will send a certificate, just like the server sent a certificate. After that, things are going the same, except that it also sends, after starting the encryption, it will send a certificate verify. Why? Because a certificate is a public piece of information. Anybody can own that certificate. But the only person that has a private key belonging to that certificate is the person having that certificate. So it needs to do something to prove that it's having a private key. And to prove that, after the encryption starts, it sends a verify message that's been signed by the private key in the certificate, or that belongs to the certificate. And that way the server can check with the public key that's in the certificate, it can check whether actually this person has the private key of the certificate. Again, Oh, sorry, it's not. Sorry, encryption is after this message. If the server checks whether the message has been signed by the private key of the certificate, then it knows that the client is indeed who he tells who he is, and then he can finish the session and they can start communicating. Well, the certificate request is a very simple message. It accepts certain types of signatures, and it gives an advertisement of which the CAs are advised to use for sending a client certificate. It's not a restrictive list, so this list is just an advice. So if you have four CAs that you accept certificates from, you can tell the client, okay, please send me a certificate signed by either one of these four CAs. But the client is able to send a certificate from another CA. And it could be that that CA is accepted as well. So this is just an advice, and this advice has been used by your browser. If you have like 20 client CAs in your certificate store, and only one is signed by one of these CAs, that's the one that will be sent by your browser. Or that's how it works. Well, this we have seen before, a certificate message. It's the same as a server certificate message, the same setup. Then the certificate verify message is again a piece of data being signed by the private key in the certificate. And that's how normal sessions are being set up. Any questions so far? Okay. Then, as I told you before, you can reuse SSL sessions because the client key exchange and the decryption of the client key exchange with the private key from the server, those are expensive calculations. So it might be useful to reduce those calculations by reusing sessions. So both the client and the server, they cache those sessions. And whenever a new TCP session that wants to use SSL is starting, they can reuse the old pre-master secret that has been exchanged before. They are indexed by the SSL session ID, and the SSL sessions will be timed out not by being idle. They will be timed out with an absolute timestamp. And it used to be 2 minutes in Internet Explorer, and now it's 10 hours, I think. So what happens in a reused session handshake? You first get a client hello. And in the client hello, the client says, OK, I'm going to reuse the session with this session ID. Then there's a server hello. And if he still has the session in his cache, he will just say, OK, let's go to encryption straight away. Let's not exchange a new pre-master secret. Then there's finished, of course, again. And then the client goes into change cyberspec to start encryption. If you look at Wireshark, if I add two columns, one column for the SSL, this one is not very interesting. It's the SSL ID column that's interesting. So I added that to my columns. And then when you look here, there's the first part of the SSL session ID being given back by the server once the client made a connection without any SSL ID. So the client didn't have an SSL ID for the server. It created a session to the server. The server gave back a session ID. And then for the next session, so this is a full handshake, sorry. For the next session, you see that the client uses the same SSL session ID to recreate the session. The server also says, OK, we can use the session again. And you will see a partial handshake. Then after a while, the client comes back. And it says, I want to use this session again. But then the server says, no, I don't have that session in my cache anymore. I create a new session ID for you. And then, of course, it will be a new full handshake. And why is this happening? Because I configured my server to use 60 seconds as a timeout for the session ID. No, usually, it's much longer than that. If a server doesn't want to use session reuse, it can and the client comes with a session ID, then it can tell just, OK, I have a session ID length of 0, and I won't do any session resumption for this session. In the case when you use session IDs, the server needs to cache the information, the pre-master secret, and the client needs to cache the pre-master secret. When there's a server with a lot of traffic from a lot of customers, then this cache can grow pretty large. So there's a new method in TLS, and that's using session tickets. With session tickets, we also cache the information, but we only cache it on the client. So the state of the session is not kept on the server. It's kept on the client. And the client presents the state to the server to start the whole process again. It's an extension in the client and the server hello. And there's a new handshake message type, and that's a new session ticket. Of course, this ticket needs to be encrypted with something, because otherwise anybody that receives the ticket, sniffing somewhere in between, can reuse it. So it's been encrypted by the server with something only the server knows. In case of a session ticket, the client hello is the same. The extension is there for a session ticket, but it has length 0. The server hello is the same. It has a length 0 on the session ticket as well. But then after the client finalizes the session, the server sends a new session ticket to the client, and the client caches that information on in its cache. And when it creates a new connection to the server, it starts with the client hello, including the ticket. And then the server says, OK, I recognize your ticket. It's been encrypted by me. I can decrypt it. So we have the same session information again. And it will go straight to the encryption phase. OK. This is how that looks in Wireshark. In a client hello, you have a session ticket extension with length 0. Then in the server hello, you have a session ticket with length 0. Then the client or the server sends the new session ticket to the client. And then when the client comes back with the client hello, there's your ticket being sent back to the server. And this way, the server does not need to cache all the pre-master secrets because they're cached on the client. OK. Then the last record type, the alert message, is a very simple message. This is encrypted, so when we do decryption, it will look a little bit different. But it's just an alert message. It has a level and a description. So there's a level, can be warning or error or anything. And then there's certain alert types, of which one is the close notify, which will be used at the end of a TLS session to close the connection. So how can we analyze SSL application data? The last message type that we didn't discuss yet is application data, which is simply a header. Okay, this is application data, and the encrypted data is in the record type or in the SSL records. So those are the four types of messages that you can see in SSL. Then we have, since I don't know how long, but it's been upcoming, elliptic curve cryptology. Why do we use that? Well, first of all, the key sizes are a lot smaller. If you take the strength of a key with symmetric encryption, then say there's a key with 128 bits, then that is equivalent to a 3K key for RSA. But if you use elliptical curve, it's only a key of 283 bits. So it uses a lot smaller key sizes to create the same strength of encryption, which is nice, because in these worlds, our mobile phones, they have quite some power, but still they have limited power and limited batteries and limited memory and stuff like that. So it's useful that it uses less CPU cycles. It uses less memory, and since the keys that are exchanged over the network are smaller, it uses less bandwidth as well. So what you see nowadays is that almost all TLS connections use elliptic curve cryptography. If you look here, all the first ones are elliptical curve. Here's the first RSA one. That's only 3.6%. I took this from, I'm not sure which side anymore, but it keeps track of what has been seen in the field. What you do see is that from these ciphers, there you see that some of them are using an RSA certificate and some of them are using an elliptical curve certificate. So this is the key exchange mechanism, and this is the certificate type that's being used for the connection. So a lot of them still use RSA certificates, and that's because it need, most of the CAs are still RSA CAs. So if you wanted to get a certificate from them, you need to have an RSA key pair yourself as well. When you have an elliptical curve exchange with an elliptical curve certificate, well, there's some. This is how it's been done. The service certificate must contain an elliptical curve capable public key and be signed with an elliptical curve key from the CA. Then the server sends its ephemeral, so it's temporary public key. And since there are several curves and several ways that that you can choose your curve, it needs to send some information about the curve being used in a server key exchange message. It will be signed with the public with the private key of the certificate and being sent by to the other side. Then the client generates his elliptical curve key pair on the same curve, and then it sends it back to the back to the server. And it encrypts it with a public key. And then from those messages, both can use that to create the pre-master secret. So that's what's being new in elliptical curves. If you use an RSA certificate, it's pretty much the same, except that you need to use RSA public keys instead of the elliptical curve ones. So it's about the same. This will be important when we start doing decryption, because with a Diffie-Hellman exchange, the pre-master secret is not being transferred encrypted with the public key from the certificate. So we will see that in a minute that this becomes a problem. So what do we do when we want to decrypt SSL? Well, in an RSA key exchange, we have seen that the generated keying information for the connection will be encrypted with the public key from the certificate. So if we provide the server private key to Wireshark, we can decrypt the client key exchange and therefore retrieve the pre-master secret for this connection. Of course, this works only when we have the whole session, the full handshake. If you have a resumed session, we have seen that there is no client key exchange. So we can't decrypt the pre-master secret, so we can't do any decryption. This also works with client authentication, because in client authentication, the client private key is not used to create the session keys. It's only being used for authentication. So you can still use only the server key, private key, to do decryption, even when it's a client authenticated session. But with ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key generation, like the one in elliptic curve, for instance, there is a server key exchange present, and we can't decrypt that. So we're lost with when we try to use the private key. The only way to do decryption then is to have either the client or the server log and make a log of all the used pre-master secrets. You can do that for Firefox and Chrome. They use the NSS SSL library. And you can set the SSL keylog file environment variable on your system and then start up your browser. And then it will start logging those pre-master secrets to file. Or you can use, I'm not sure, OpenSSL will show you the pre-master secret. I'm not sure about other tools. They're able to log the pre-master secrets. But if anybody knows, please speak up. OK, then there's the option in Wireshark, either by doing this kind of decryption or that kind of decryption, to export the SSL session keys back to a file. And then you can use that file to provide to a third party to decrypt sessions in that specific trace file. OK, how do we provide the server private key to Wireshark? There is an option in the SSL protocol preferences there's a list of an RSC keys list. If you open it up, you can add the server IP address. So you click on new, create a new session or new entry. The server IP address, the port on which it is listening. And then when you need to tell Wireshark, once you've done decryption, what kind of protocol was in the SSL session. So we tell it to use HTTP in this case. And I tell it where the key for this specific server is. That will be listed in your preferences in an SSL keys file, which contains also these parameters. Then, if you want to troubleshoot the decryption, you can enable SSL debug to a file, and it will send a lot of interesting information to the log file. But it sends a lot of information. I was just talking to one of the other core developers. We need to put this somewhere, maybe in an expert info, or restrict the limit use of the debug file to only interesting messages for the user. But that's not there yet, so you have to browse through the whole debug file to see what the problem was. Well, one of the first things that you will see if the key is not imported correctly is can't import PEM data. Sometimes it's because you use not a private key without a passphrase, but you use a private key that has a passphrase in it. Wireshark can't use it. You need to have a private key without a passphrase. Or you can use a PK, if it's a PEM certificate, you have to do it without a passphrase. If it's a PKCS12 certificate, you can use a passphrase, and Wireshark can use the passphrase to decrypt it. So if you have an encrypted key and you need to decrypt it, you can use the OpenSSL tool to do that. And if it's a DAIR formatted file, which is a binary format and not a PEM format, then you can use OpenSSL to transform the DAIR formatted file into a PEM formatted file. Or you can use OpenSSL to create a PKCS12 certificate, and then you can add a passphrase. If you don't want to have the key on your laptop without a passphrase, this is a way to do that. Always make sure that you remove the keys when you're done, because, of course, they're private keys, so you don't want to leave them hanging around on your laptop, if you get them at all. So what happens when you do decryption? There's, of course, the application layer. And then behind after the application layer, there's the hypertext. So it will give you an extra layer with the decrypted information. So if you want to decrypt, you can decrypt any kind of SSL, not only HTTPS. So if you want to decrypt IMAP, for instance, you can use IMAP as the underlying protocol. Of course, I'm using port 993 in this case, because that's the port for our IMAP. And then you'll see that it's decrypted into IMAP. Then if you use, for instance, SMTP, it starts off with clear text communication, and then it starts doing SSL. If you want to decrypt that, you could put SMTP in there, but then it will interpret all data as SSL, and the first part is not SSL. So then you use, instead of the port 25, you will use start TLS, and it will make sure that it starts, it doesn't start interpreting things as SSL before the start TLS has been given. So this way you can see the whole session. So what happens if you run into trouble decrypting SSL? First of all, there's the I see here that the key has been successfully loaded, but still I don't see any decryption. So what is happening here? If you look close, you will see it's a client hello, server hello, change IRIS spec. So this is a resume session. It doesn't contain the client key exchange, so even if I do have the private key, I can't decrypt it. And that's what it says here. It's a little bit difficult to see in the log file. Therefore, I think we need to change that, but it's not there yet. But you will not see here, what you're missing for this session is the encrypted pre-master secret. You should see an encrypted pre-master secret, then you know that Wireshark is able to read it. So please make sure that the whole SSL session is in your trace file. Normally, you would see this. You would normally see can't decrypt pre-master secret. This means that you did provide a private key, but the private key does not match the public key in the certificate. Well, there's a way to check that. I can export the certificate that was in the trace file. Then I check which key I'm using in my Wireshark preferences, and I'm going to use OpenSSL to check whether those are the same. And what you see here is that even though it says public.sharkfs.local, if I look at the public.sharkfs.local key, it has a different fingerprint. Then I check whether the private.sharkfs.local key has the right fingerprints, and it had the right fingerprint. So I messed them up importing them into Wireshark. So please make sure that the server key is matching the server certificate. Okay. Then I'm having a third one. Let's see. In this case, the cipher suite that's been chosen by the server, I'm looking at the server hello message, it's an encrypted elliptical curve Diffie-Hellman cipher suite, which means it's a Diffie-Hellman key exchange, so my private key won't help me here doing decryption. So please make sure that if you're trying to do decryption, you either change the accepted ciphers to something that's using an RSA key exchange, or that you log your session keys in the browser. If you log your session keys in the browser, how does that work in Wireshark to do the decryption? Well, you are using the unencrypted pre-master secrets from the browser, like with the SSL keylog file. Or you can use it, for instance, with OpenSSL S-Client. And those will be listed in a file. You can choose the SSL preference pre-master secret log file name in the SSL preferences. There's several formats of the entries in the file. This is from the source code of Wireshark. This is the first format that was used, and nowadays almost all logged sessions are using the client random as an index, because not all sessions are using a session ID to do session resumption. So I tried that on my Mac. I'm exporting SSL keylog file to sslkeylogfile.log. Then I started Chrome, and I need to start it from the command line, because if I start it from the applications folder, then it won't use this session variable. And then when I stopped and I looked at the keylog file, I only looked at the first three entries. There were client random, so this is the client random from the client hello, and this is the pre-master secret from the key exchange, or the generated pre-master secret. I can now use these to do decryption. So there's a client hello, server hello. I again see the Diffie-Hellman, the key exchange or key generation. But since I provided the pre-master secrets indexed by the client random, I'm able to do decryption, as you can see here. This is not an encrypted handshake message anymore, but it's the finish message. And you see here the HTTP2 application data. So you can use OpenSSL client, S-Client, to do that as well. If you open a connection to a server, it will log the session ID, and it will log the master key. And you can use those. With a little awk script, you can do it automatically, but you can also do that by hand. You create a new RSA session ID entry with the master key, and then you can use this to do the decryption of this specific SSL session. So if you're able to test stuff with OpenSSL S-Client, or you can tunnel stuff through there, then you are able to do decryption for those sessions as well. Of course, again, you need to fill in this file in the pre-master secret log file name in the SSL preferences. And then I will see here that it's really showing you the decrypted message. Okay, So when you did encryption or decryption, you can export SSL session keys. If you need to contact like a vendor and they need to troubleshoot an issue and they need to look into the data, you don't want to give them the private key. But you can give them the session keys, because those keys can only decrypt those specific sessions that you are providing to them. So you export the file, or export the keys with file, export SSL session keys. And it will create a file that you just saw created by the SSL keylog file. And of course, if the vendor needs to import that, it uses the SSL preferences and the pre-master secret log file name setting. This way, you can provide SSL decryption to other parties that you don't want to send a private key to. Then in Wireshark, how do you do decryption? In T-Shark. You can do -V to show the whole tree of the packet, including the decrypted application data. So you first need to find out where to put those settings. This is a nice shortcut to get all the SSL preferences from the current version of Wireshark, of T-Shark. So I can provide -o SSL key list and then the settings that we used earlier. Also, you can add the debug file, or you can use the keylog file. In this case, I had a session to Google with the session that you saw earlier. I logged the session keys and I extracted the one for the stream 37. So I extracted the stream 37 to a separate file. And if I'm reading this with the keylog file that I just created, and I'm just selecting SSL traffic, you see that it's SSL, it's decrypted handshake message, and then here's the HTTP2 traffic decrypted. If I use -V to show the actual content, I'm just looking at frame number 14, which is this magic message, and I'm just interested in the total dissection of HTTP2, then you will see that here's the decrypted HTTP2 message from the client. So this way you can automate decryption as well if you want to check stuff with the T-Shark. Still 5 minutes time, so let's see. What can you do when you can't do decryption? Because in a lot of cases you're not able to do decryption. Can you still say something interesting about the trace file and the application data when you don't have encryption or decryption? Well, if you add a record, another column with the field SSL record content type, if you filter on SSL content type 23, which means application data, you will get only the packets with application data. And if you then add a column for the SSL record length, you can see the timing of messages going back and forth. So if you look at the timestamps between them, between client and server and to client packets, and you check the record length, you get an indication of the length of the request and the length of the response, even though you don't see the actual content. So in this case, what can we say about this trace file? I filtered on application data, and I see that there's a application data coming from the point 1 to the point 3, and then 2 milliseconds later, there's a response. And the response, while the request was a little less than 432 bytes, the response was a little less than these combined. And then after a while, you see the same message length reappearing. So you know that this is actually the same, or you don't know, but you can assume that this is the same request and response happening each time. So you can still say something about this this traffic. So you can have response times from your server request. You can have an indication how big the request was and an indication how big the response was. So if you're able to have a decrypted trace next to it or this, or you have a backend trace where the traffic was decrypted, you can still kind of match the encrypted traffic with the decrypted traffic behind, for instance, a load balancer. The question is, why do I have two values in the SSL length column, right? That's because there's actually two SSL records for this particular response. In this particular response, there's first the HTTP header, and then there's the HTTP content, and they're being put in two separate SSL records. So there can be more messages from client to server, so you need to combine them all because it can be split over multiple packets. And again, in the response, there can be multiple SSL records containing the response data, so you need to add them all up to get the total value of the length. Okay, I think I've got two more minutes left. So some common SSL handshake problems. Sometimes the session stops right after the client hello, and there can be several causes. One of them is no mutually supported SSL version. So if I'm trying to connect with SSL version 3 and the server only accepts TLS 1.0 or higher, then I won't get a connection. The same goes for ciphers. If I present a certain cipher list and the server doesn't accept any of those ciphers, you can't make a proper connection. It could also be that I have a server name indication field for a certain server name and that the server doesn't have a certificate for that connection. That all means that you can't get a proper connection and it will stop after the client hello. Then if the session stops right after you receive the certificate from the server, there's quite a few things that can be wrong. The common name in the certificate might not match the one in the that you requested in the host name. So your browser will say, I won't go to this site, so it will stop the session. Maybe the root certificate for the server certificate is not in the client trust store, so maybe the certificate has been signed by a certificate authority that you don't trust, or that you deleted out of your browser. It could be that the client has the root certificate, but the server was signed by an intermediate certificate and it didn't provide the intermediate certificate to the client, then it can't make a match between the server certificate and the root certificate, so you need that intermediate one. That's one of the things that are happening a lot, so you have to configure your intermediate certificate. It could also be that some browsers are able to connect and some don't, because usually browsers cache those intermediate certificates. So if a browser was visiting a site that was signed by this intermediate before, it can use that cached intermediate and then it is able to make a connection. And then another browser that didn't visit such a site, it can't make a connection. It could be that the server certificate has been expired or that it has been revoked. Well, the same goes for when you do client authentication and the session stops right after the certificate from the client. Well, there's about the same reasons, but there's also one extra. The CRL has been expired of the, well, that can be happen at the server certificate as well, but the CRL can be expired, or the client certificate chain is too long because the server has been configured with a chain length. So if as an extra protection that you don't have a certificate that's been signed by any of the intermediate certificates. So we have seen that SSL is a trust model based on cryptography. To analyze SSL, you can analyze the SSL handshake to solve connection problems, and you can decrypt traffic to solve application issues or look at the timings of the packages when it's not decrypted. So use the private key for RSA key exchange and use logging of the pre-master secret for all others. Any questions? There's a lot of text going this way, but any questions? If not, one.
You're adding it that the sessions will stop if an error occurs. Will there be a reset from server or client? Or?
It depends. In a lot of times, the client or the server will actually give an SSL alert. So if you look at SSL alert, you get an indication of what was wrong. If it doesn't send, the question is how do you see that the session was terminated? So if you look at the trace, sometimes you will see an SSL alert telling you what was wrong. Sometimes it will be reset, but most of the time it will just be a finish message and a normal closure of the session.
Okay.
What?
Or there is an application error.
Application error in what sense?
Yeah, could be.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Any more questions?
Mm-hmm. What are the three most important things to look for?
The three most important things to look for in the debug file?
Yeah.
The first is if the key was loaded properly, because if the key wasn't loaded properly, then it won't work. The second one will be if for your specific session there is indeed the pre-master secret, and it tells you that the pre-master secret can be decrypted. And those, I think, are the two most prevalent ones, and I'm not going to think of third at the moment. That's why we need expert info to present it to the user, probably. Yeah. Any other question? In that case, thank you.